Yeah, we on Boss Talk 101. Yeah, we gon' talk, we gon' have fun.
Yeah.
We be on fire, we be lit lit.
Yeah.
It's a unique hustle, big shit.
Yeah.
Big shit,
big shit,
big shit.
Yeah.
It's a unique hustle, nigga, big shit. Big shit,
big shit,
big shit.
Big shit.
Name another podcast like this.
Yeah.
Who gon' bring it to the table? Boss Talk.
Check it, check it, check it. It's a unique hustle. It's your boy ECEO, and I'm here with the lovely, incredible Miss Jamaica, what's going on?
Nothing, my dad walk on.
Say, man. Hey, God done dropped a bomb on us.
I know.
Say, man, you here, man. Yeah, look here, man. You niggas been watching him. He work. He can't be denied, nigga. The man done put it. Hey, BMF?
I know.
Hey, man, this dude here, not only that, the nigga really, really created a whole nother Pac wave, to be honest with you, for me. I seen it, man. The boy, hey, man, I love this cat, man.
Come on, man.
Zane in the building. Lil Zane, what's up, baby?
Hey, man, good to be here, man. How you feeling, B-Dog?
Man, hey, man, I feel real good, man,
hey,
now
man.
That you here.
Hey, Boss Talk, man.
Hey, 101, what a boss is talk.
101, what a boss is talk, man. I like this whole setup, too, man.
Man, thank you, man.
Yeah.
Hey, man, we've been going up, man.
Yeah.
I never seen it coming. I'm like, dang, man, when we first got this place, when we first got the ball, you know, because we've been there 15 years, but the whole little old setup, I was just doing the same. I'm going to bring some people in. But then my nigga D-Map from out of Atlanta, shout out D-Map, he designed for 8732 and the clothing brands back for
sure.
Jewel House for Boosie.
Yeah.
He called me, he said, man, E, thank you, man. You did it. Hey, man, I love what you're doing for the culture. Like, nigga, I ain't do this for no culture. The nigga called me because he seen it.
Nigga, this something I just
did. I just do it for me, nigga. But now the people loving it. So God has his own way of doing things, man. So what you think?
He planned one thing and God has another plan in store.
Man, he's always on time, right?
Mm-hmm.
Check it, man.
But we want to know a little bit about you.
Mm.
Growing up, where you from?
Growing
your household, your siblings. We want to get all in that business.
Man, let's get into it, man. Well, growing up, you know, born in Yonkers, New York.
Mm.
What?
Yeah, but you don't even have that New York accent.
He been in
like
Atlanta
that.
A while.
Been in Atlanta for a minute, though.
Okay.
But, you know, all my family from Yonkers, New York, though.
How old were you when you left?
I was young, like probably like four. You know,
okay,
three,
yeah,
four,
yeah,
so
yeah. Understandable.
Moved to Atlanta. Moved to Atlanta like three or four. My mom and pops. My mom and pops been together for like, what going on? I think this day 40th anniversary.
Ooh.
Maybe like 35, 35 or
40. We trying to get there, girl. We trying to get there, man.
We going to get there.
All right.
You know what I'm saying?
I'm riding with you.
You know what I'm saying? Came from a household with both, you know. It's a weird story with me, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's a weird story.
Well, listen, we got time to
do
it.
We got
time to do it.
I got the book coming. You know what I'm saying?
But
you know
what I'm saying?
You know, shout out, you know what I'm saying, to my pops. You know what I'm saying? My mom's like, I came from like, you know, a family where, you know, the pops was there, moms was there, you know what I'm saying? And I had siblings, you know.
How many siblings?
I got three other siblings. I'm the oldest of four.
Wow.
And
what's up?
So always been like the person that just like.
That everybody looked up to.
Got everything first, like got the ass whooping first, had to go through the BS first, you know. And and always that's what made me who I am, though, because it's like I always had to share, you know, some of my brothers. And so it made me like. Not a hater, like someone that's, I get a shirt off my back, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
How much older are you then than your siblings?
Like 2 years older than my, 2 years
the
older
one,
than
one. Okay, the one
under
below,
me.
Under you.
Then I got one, I'm like 4 years older than, 5 years older than, and then I got a sister, I'm like 6 years older.
And all of you raised in the same household?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
You know what I mean? So, you know, we grew up in, they all was born
in Atlanta
though.
Okay.
You know, so me, I was born in Yonkers, New York. Moved to Atlanta when I was like four.
Did your parents ever tell you why move to Atlanta out of anywhere else? Just why Atlanta?
Yeah, we were actually, you know, my dad started like, you know, he was hustling out there. And I think it was a shootout or something. Like it was in a shootout or something. My brothers, it was like, I don't really remember it like that. But we was in a shootout in the park or something. And they found me like laid over my brother. You know what I mean? So that. From that day, they was just like, yo, it's time to pack up. I think, like, they told me they moved, like, the next day. So,
That's dope. So
boom, that happened. Shootout, we moved to Atlanta. And then from, like, you know, five until I was probably, like, 21, I lived in Atlanta doing music. Went to school in Atlanta, raised in Atlanta, elementary, junior high, you know, high school. So Atlanta's, like, where, if somebody asks me where I'm from, it's, like, Atlanta's where I'm from.
How old were you when you found a love for music?
Oh, man, love for music. First song I ever learned was Before I Let Go by Frankie Beverly and Maze.
Mm.
Yeah, Before
that's,
I Let
that's
Go.
That's heavy right there, boy.
Yeah, Before I Let Go, Frankie Beverly and Maze, Whitney Houston, my mom, all those songs, them classic songs my mom used to play while she was cleaning up or something. that's how I grew up on music. So Frankie Beverly and Mays, Whitney Houston, Bobby Brown.
No, so she had a love for music, not your dad as much.
Yeah, my mom and my dad, like, just really, they none of them did music. My dad writes, though.
Oh, okay.
Like, I think I get my poetry from, like,
your dad.
My dad, because my dad got over, like, 10,000 poems, you know what I'm saying? So he was a writer for sure. I got my name from Zane Grey, too, the writer Zane Grey.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, that's so cool. I think names are important.
Very important. Very.
My grandma named my dad after Zane Grey. I mean, after Zane, you know, the writer. Mm-hmm. He ended up being a writer, you know, not a professional writer, but, like, if it's funerals or anything, they like, yo, Big Zane, write something. And he's Big Zane. Like, that's not my stage name. Like, Lil Zane is really, like, your dad's name Larry, you know what I mean? You Larry Jr. Mm-hmm. So they call you Lil Larry.
Yeah, everybody Lil might think Lil E. I'm Lil E.
Yeah, yeah. But they might think it's a, like, no matter how, your dad's still alive.
I know he passed away, but okay, I'm still Lil E when it comes down to that.
See, we can relate. Me up on that.
But hold on. But you've told me. When I tell him, I say, you junior. He's like, no, I'm not junior no more. I'm senior now because he passed away.
I am senior, but I'm still.
A lot of people say, well, you know what I'm saying? You Lil Zane, why you change your name? Boom, boom. But I'm like, it ain't no stage name for me. Like, mm-mm. In my house, you got to say, like, Big Zane, Lil Zane. You got to say one of those because both of us come downstairs
and
just
say that's
Zane.
It.
And now I have a son named Zane. So,
hey.
But he's the third?
No, he's Baby Z. So I changed. He doesn't have the same exact. He's Zane Jeremiah Copeland.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying?
That's still dope.
Yeah, I'm Zane Rudolph Copeland. I got the fucked up. You know what I'm I wasn't trying to do that to him. You know what I'm saying?
Did you ever get teased about that middle name?
Did I? Oh my God. Every Christmas come around, this motherfucker. I hate it. I hated right Christmas. There. Yo, don't sing that shit. Rudolph the Red. Get the fuck out of here with that shit. Yeah, yeah. But that's crazy. So, you know, I changed my son's name up just so he have his own identity. You know, so, but growing up, people always say, why you change your name? Whatever. It's like, I feel like you was like Big Zane is till he passed, till if some, Lord forbid, some, I don't really feel comfortable saying, oh, Big Zane. No matter how much money I got, how much shit I did, it's like, you always Lil E.
I'm gonna always be Lil E. And I respected him to the day he died.
My dad to the fullest.
I don't play with that. Like,
and
I never
play with it, yeah.
No cursing, no none of that. I was respectful,
right,
man. I don't play like that.
Right, you're right.
And he passed away, but still, I know that, you know, I did what I was supposed to do.
Man, like,
I can sleep at night. You know what I mean?
That's real, man. Like, and that's funny you said that, because me and my pops ain't really seeing eye to eye right now. Like, you know,
I went there with mine too for years, but it ain't too late.
But yeah, but lately I've been reaching out and stuff. Like, he just had a birthday on Thanksgiving, so I just been reaching out because, like, life is so short, man.
It is.
You know what I'm saying?
It is.
You don't want to get that call, or, you know what I'm saying? You just like, damn, I should have.
Yeah.
Boom, boom, boom. And like you said, I got so much respect for him. It's like, how can you say you got so much respect for him? And still,
I had to.
When they wrong, dog,
they still
I be
right.
Feeling like, I be feeling like my dog wrong sometimes, but I be like, just because I have so much respect. It's like, damn, I gotta.
You know how dads is.
Our dad, they ain't gonna call us, bro.
No.
Cause they got that
pride.
They got that pride, like, cause they know they was there for
That's
us.
That's right.
They know they was there.
I broke my leg, and my dad still didn't even come to the hospital. We hadn't spoken a year and something, and I was hurt behind that.
Wow.
My stepdad was at the hospital. I was like, dude, where my dad at? I was really pissed.
Wow.
But I knew we wasn't seeing eye to eye when it had happened. But at the end of the day, he eventually came to see me. But they got this thing that you disrespected to God, nigga.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
And especially when they know they've been there for us.
Exactly.
It's like, nigga, no matter what I did, what I said.
That's it.
I was there fucking 20. How is you now, nigga? I'm still there.
I was there when you was born.
Wow.
That's the part where you forget, because you can't remember that.
Wow.
But they was there.
Wow.
But I would think, too, because y'all are now fathers, you know, you going to be that person down the line where you have to deal with your child, and your child going to be thinking the same thing that you're thinking right now.
Yeah, yeah.
It's crazy. You know, yeah and no, because, you know, it's a lot of things I would do different, you know what I'm saying, with my kids than my dad did with me, too. Not saying.
Yeah, but that nigga, see that nigga right there? I thought the same way, but my son, yeah, he was mad at me on a couple of things.
Yeah.
He didn't say it,
yeah.
But then somebody else come back and like, yeah, he don't see how he quiet, but yeah, he ain't too much feeling that, such. So I think you don't get around those blows. You could try.
Mm.
But it's just something to where it's going to be those times. But those are the times that you grow in.
Yeah.
That relationship is growing when you go through those stages.
Yeah. And then it's like being a father, too. It's like, you know, now when we discipline our kids or whatever, it hurt us more.
Yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, damn, like I thought he was being the worst, but he's probably
doing
he's
it for
probably
you.
it's probably hurt him more than it hurt shit. Yeah, you know what I'm saying? Right. So now having kids, I realize that, like, you know, I scream at my kids sometime or they put on punishment and 2 minutes later I'm like, what y'all want from the store?
Yeah.
Let me give you an example of something that I went through with my mom. Like, you know, growing up, you know how, like, for me personally, I used to always say that I'd wish that she would say, I'm proud of you. Because I would never get that, but I'd get all the love, the hugs, I love you, all of that. But I just wanted to hear that. So as I got older, I'm like, why you never told me that? Well, for her, her mom never told her she loved her. Mm. So she overcompensated with that for me. Mm. So you didn't get something from your dad, you're going to overcompensate for your child with that. But there's always something that's lagging that child is going to be like, but he didn't do this.
Yeah.
No matter what.
Damn.
No matter what. And that's the crazy. And then you learn that, you know, parents ain't perfect.
Nobody's perfect.
But as a kid, you want it. You think it is. Like,
yes.
But then you just learn, like, growing up, it's like, sometimes my son be doing some things, and I be like, yo, I was doing that. Like, he'll tell you, be like, yo, that's your son, dog. Like, you know, so you see it.
That's your boy, for sure.
Yeah, so, man, shout out to Pops. All the real dads out there. All the real pops out there. Because we don't get enough credit, man.
Nah. We don't, and we get gifts for Father's Day. I get it, man.
Come on,
yeah,
man.
They be hating on us. They love their mama more, even though you do everything you could tell.
Girls love their daddies more.
They don't ride with you like they
girls
ride with mama.
Girls are daddy's little girls.
Girls love their dad more.
Thank you.
My little girl love me, though. Like, I can't do no wrong in her eyes.
Don't look at me.
I don't want to hear that. We got Zane in here, man. Let's get to it. Yeah, Zane. How did you end up on BMF? How did you end up dealing with 50 on that?
Man, it's just been a long journey, man. Just you know, I went on a couple auditions, you know, and Tasha called me. Well, my agent called me and was like, "We got this audition for you." I didn't know what it was at the time, and when he sent it to me, I saw it was a BMF. I went into it like I didn't really even think I was gonna get it. I ain't even gonna hold you like. I was just like, I ain't gonna get this shit. And I just went in there, kind of did it, like, you know, like I didn't care about it. But I guess the part called for that. The part called for somebody with an attitude.
Nonchalant. Somebody nonchalant. Whatever.
So it's like, literally, like, usually when I do an audition, I might do it like 3-4 times and sit there and look at it, pick the best one. But this one, I just did it that one time and was just like, all right, sit in there. Like, really, like, me and you talking, I'm like,
So it's a video audition you had
to
do.
Yeah,
it was a taping.
It was an in-person. You know what I mean? It wasn't an in-person, it was a taping. And that's another thing, too, man. Sometimes, you know, I think when you go in-person, you be nervous. You know what I'm saying?
Of course.
Because it's somebody really just reading it to you, like, you all into it. Like, you like, yeah, and blah, blah. And they're just like this. So what did you do yesterday? Okay, boom, boy. That's their job, to just be straight, plain, nonchalant, and you still gotta
have that energy,
everything, right?
And you're trying to read their emotion, and they're not showing any.
So when you do the self tape, it's kind of like a little different because you're not expecting. So you just, you know what I mean, self tape. You already mentally like, okay, it's just me. But when you naturally, if you're in a room and we're giving each other, we're feeding off of each other, you want that feed off.
Yeah.
So I don't think I was doing too good with. And I don't do too good with in person.
You like the ones that you have to send.
I think I do not. You know, I'm gonna take that back because I booked before. But what I want to say is, it's better to me to self tape. Is like, because you got a chance to do it a couple times,
look at it, send the best one.
I think that's the fairest. But when you get in, you might have a bad day right before you got an audition. So now that affects your in-person audition.
But you don't know what they're looking for. Just like you said, you know, you went in with this don't care attitude and you didn't realize that that's what they were looking for.
Winning with a don't care attitude.
Exactly.
That's what they was looking for. About 2 weeks later, I heard back, okay, you want standby? I was like, all right, cool, just stand by me. My agent's like, just stand by.
Stand by.
I'm like, all right. So you can't really plan nothing else. Shit coming in, you just like, okay, I can't really do nothing. Then another week went by. So for about 3 weeks, you know, it was just that. Did he get it? Boom, boom. So finally they called. It was like, you shoot on this day. Boom, boom. And it was just crazy. Like, so, but I worked with Tasha about 2-3 years before I did BMF on a movie called When Love Kills.
Okay. Mm.
And I had a small part in it. I was a little DJ in it. And but she said that one line, I was in the corner, like, practicing it. Like, it was the last line, the only line I ever had in life. She was like, he over there practicing that one line. And basically, you know, the work ethic. She was just like, I knew I wanted to work with you on something else. So BMF came up, did my little, you know, my little 1-2 boom on the audition. So I guess when it came across the table, just timing.
I like it, man. You know I think that's dope. I really like the way that you working, nigga. Yeah. Shit, you working. These niggas, I don't understand. We here.
Acting classes when nobody looking. Yeah. Acting classes, watching a lot of movies, I'm a movie connoisseur. Like, I love watching films, but it's hard for me to just watch a movie because I'm looking at the moments, the
you're
pauses.
You're looking at the different things.
You know, because I want to be the best. I'm watching the Denzels. I study Denzel.
Do you imitate their accents and stuff like that?
You know, one thing about me, I can imitate almost any accent. I think since a kid, that's been like my gift. Like, if I hear something enough,
what's the best accent that you can imitate?
I mean, I can't
something.
Really say, oh, this is my such as this accent. I just know, like, I can get on the phone and do some.
Don't you, do
you
it,
won't
man.
Think, you won't think it's me. You won't think it's me, you know what I'm saying? But my man be saying it's racist sometimes. He be saying it's racist.
look.
If I walk in a Jamaican store, I'm talking to my brethren. Brethren, what's up, brethren?
You know she Jamaican,
my youth,
right?
My youth. You know what I'm saying? We go down yonder, down yard. We go to yard. You know what I'm saying? So, but you know, it's just... With me, it's like I love people, man. I love culture. You know what I'm saying? I love different cultures. So It don't be me trying to be funny. I'm really just trying to
embrace
relate,
it.
You know
right?
what I'm trying to embrace it. Like, Chinese people might say, like, you know, growing up watching Chinese flicks, you know what I'm saying? When I try to talk like them, I wasn't trying to be racist. I was trying to, like, yo, this is cool to me. Like, I'm one of them kids that mad because I don't know how to speak a language.
Yeah, some people look at it as that. You're mocking them.
Yeah,
that's
whatever.
What they look
yeah,
at
like, I always tell people, I told my kids the other day, I was like, yo, if y'all don't do nothing, learn a language from me.
Mm-hmm.
Like, just learn a language from me. Just pick one and learn it. Like,
yeah,
you know, my kids is Spanish. They mix with Spanish. They don't even know Spanish. I'm like, yeah, y'all need to learn a language because really it's important. And I'm like, if that's something I could do all over again, I would have took a language in school because mm-hmm. you go across the world and like people be speaking these languages and you'd be like, damn, I really don't. You know what I'm saying? And I can understand Jamaican more. Though. That's why certain places I go, like the Caribbean, Caribbean has that broken accent,
English.
Mm-hmm. So it's easier for me to relate when I get around Caribbean people or Jamaicans. Like, you know, I feel like somewhere down my line of my culture, I was a little Caribbean kid.
Yeah.
I love the water. I love the beach.
Man, it's nice. It's nice,
I love the
right?
ganja. I love the, you know what I'm saying? I love growing my hair out. You know, so I just feel like somewhere down the line, I was a little island boy.
So what know? I wanted to know is, okay, so... 2 years before BMF, you did a small film. So did you audition for anything in between that and BMF coming up?
Man, I auditioned for so many films. Like, you know, I got to the point where I got tired of auditioning. You know, because sometimes you keep hearing them no's, or not. You don't hear nothing at all. It don't really be you hear no. You just don't, you don't hear back at all. So it's like, you know, it gets discouraging. It gets to the point where you're like, yo, like, I need to start messing with your self-esteem, you know what I'm saying? But you can't let it. So to counteract that, I just started working on my own projects. I was like, yo, if they ain't going to give me that next role, I got to create it. You know, so I quit going on auditions for about a year. He'll tell you, he was calling me to go on auditions. I'm like, they Denzel movie. I don't want to do it.
Discouraged.
Discouraged, but also just
tired of hearing the no or not hearing nothing at all.
Once I set my mind to like, okay, I'm not doing no more auditions for the next year because it's gonna force me to just go hard on me. Mm-hmm. So it was more like I had already had my mindset like I'm gonna create my next move. You know, they're not gonna give it to me. I'm gonna create my next move. So I went in hibernation. I wrote like 20 different scripts, movie scripts, TV scripts, game shows, reality shows, and I was just calling him every day, right? Calling him every day, like, yo, I got this. He like, yo, that's crazy. I'm meeting with different producers, and they're liking the ideas, and I'm like, I started writing for artists. I'm like, you know what? I might not be on the main screen again. Mm-hmm. God might be telling me to be behind the scenes,
because
I still got this passion to do music and film, but a lot of people would think, oh, you had your chance already. You was out there, boom, boom, boom. So I was just like, whatever you do, just stay creative. Stay working, like, stay writing. Like, nobody's going to give you your part. You're going to write your next part. So I wrote this TV show called Almost Out. And I got to the point where I was having the table meetings. I had the investors. I had the locations. I'm like, I'm finna shoot me a TV show. It's like my version of Power. It's like Power meets Den of Thieves. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, so I got 50 people together, the actors, everything. He's there. You know what I'm saying? So, and then God will do it to you. Once God seen I was ready and I'm full-fledged about to go make all these hella mistakes. I know I'm about to make a bunch of mistakes. I'm playing with people's money. I'm finna make a bunch of mistakes. But
that's the only way you learn.
You know, it was my way. These are new mistakes, though. So then, right, I had scheduled to shoot January 15th, and I got a call on January 1st that we were shooting on the 21st. So I had to push. That means I had to go back and tell 50 people, like, look, we ain't shooting on the 15th. I don't know when we shooting, but
it's on pause.
By the time we shoot, we gonna be bigger than life. You know what I'm saying?
That's dope.
By the time we shoot, this BMF thing should be so big that we could walk this in anywhere.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Because right now, I'm just going off of just the old Lil Zane, what I did.
Yeah.
Hey, I wrote this. Mm-hmm. I might get to the table and they be like, okay, we like it, but we want to use such and such as this as a lead. We want to use. So, and I'm open to all that because at this point, I'm like, I'm not knowing if I'm finna be in the front or in the back. I'm
in the room.
Long as I'm in the room, I'm in the, you feel what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
I always had that. Long as I'm in the room, if I ain't number one, I'm gonna be part of whoever number one.
Yeah, and then you can create opportunity in the room too.
Yeah.
So you as long as you're in the room,
exactly.
It'll tell them what can
so
go
that's
down.
That's what I was on. I was on.
But
somewhere.
Look at God though. What I was thinking about when you're saying all of that is that you had the money to do your project, but this came up. So by you doing this, you learn a lot more about the business.
Yeah.
Correct.
Yes.
That you can now turn around and implement it into your own.
Because I was about to go make a lot of mistakes. I was about to make a lot of fun mistakes, but it was going to be a lot of mistakes because I never did it. So now I'm writing a TV show and I get a call to be
in a TV show.
On a TV show. And not only is it on a TV show, it's a true story. You kind of know this is going to be the biggest TV show in the world. I didn't know how much of it I was in. I thought I was only supposed to be in one episode.
Yeah. How did they spin it off and put
I
you?
I just kept from that one day I went in there. You know that one episode might take 7 days to shoot. So I guess just seeing us for 7 days and the writers like, yo, these dudes are actually funny. Like on set it just became just organic. Like, okay, we're gonna write them in scene. We're gonna write them in episode 2-2. All right, put them in episode 3-3. You know what I'm saying? Hey, that's just, it wasn't planned. I was only supposed to be number one.
Is 50 Cent on the set, or is he even?
At this point, I hadn't seen 50.
You hadn't seen 50.
I hadn't seen 50 till like episode 7.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I hadn't seen 50 till like episode 7.
Which is understandable. Episode 7,
because he was moving around. Yeah. And they had a lot of COVID protocols, too. You know, 50 be turned up. 50 be all over. So they was like,
hey, man, that dude, man, come on now.
That's how I knew they meant business, because even though it's his show, they was like, nigga, even you can't come on a set until you get COVID tested. And, oh, you just came from Houston? Well, you need to sit out 10 days before you come around.
Yeah,
crew.
Yeah.
So before he did his episode, he really had to stay away from everybody for 14 days. So, you know, it was crazy.
How is it working with that? Did you ever think you'd be working with 50? I know you worked with Puff and all these other different people.
I called it in 2005, right? In 2005, when 50 came out, I looked at my man, because me and my man been best friends for a while.
Yeah.
And I said, yo, 50 going to be the one to bring me back.
Wow.
I told him that. 2005, I said, yo, 50 going to be the one to bring me back, bro. And he said, because he was a cancer, I was a cancer. I didn't know how. I thought I was going to meet him, we was going to do some music. I had no idea it was going to be a
show. That's how God do it. He get you a skit up.
I'm thinking some music shit. And my cousins was cool with 50. Like, they part of, like, his little, like, you know, he got his real security, but then he got, you know, his street security, too. Like, so my cousins is, like, his little street niggas. And so every time they would do security for him, they would just see, he would see me just with them kind of, like, in the background. So I know he, like, nigga, Lil Zane is with some niggas. Like, every time I come to Atlanta and these niggas come up, they got this nigga with them. But I never would be like, yo, 50, put me on. I'd just be chilling. I'd just be chilling with the gangsters in the cut. So
that's dope.
When all that play out, you know what I'm saying, the TV show, I don't know if it had anything to do with it, but it's like, I know how cancers think. If we see you enough and we feel
it's
like,
good,
okay, he
cool.
It's like, yo, put my nigga in there. I seen my nigga around.
Yeah, yeah.
Because if he would have seen you and been like,
I don't rock
let
with
that
then
shit,
then.
Let that shit have been Ja Rule or something. Nah, hell no. That nigga's not playing soccer. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, if it's someone he don't fuck with, it's like, you would have, so, just getting to go, I'm like, damn, okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Big dog. But I, in my heart, I always thank my cousin because I'm like, I believe everything play a part. Every small thing play. I think him seeing me with you guys and, you know, Tasha seeing me put in the work on the set, that it was like, okay, I know he out here like that, so he could pull it off on some gangster shit because it ain't fake for him. He be out with the gangsters. But then on the other side is he a real actor too. He gonna put in that work too. He gonna be in the corner practicing. So boom. Now the streets and the talent meet. Preparation equals opportunity meets success, right?
Hey.
You know what I'm saying?
So when you said in 2005, so there was a time where you felt like, I gotta get back up on my good foot.
Man.
Like early on you had a deal, right, with and it wasn't a good deal.
It was a horrible,
horrible deal.
I mean, I ain't gonna say it was a horrible deal.
But it opened doors.
I ain't gonna say it was a horrible deal. Like, you know, for me, it's just...
You just signed the damn paper, then you saying?
I ain't gonna even say I just signed the paper, bro.
That's what people do, right?
I just signed the paper. It was just more like, I didn't understand the power I had.
Okay. I can dig it.
Because you constantly had somebody over you that knew you gonna have that power. Like, okay, QC and them, right?
Yeah, for sure. Shout out QC.
They tell Lil Baby, you that nigga, dog. You got the power. You could go change everything. I had a nigga over me that didn't want me to know I had that power.
Yeah.
Because he wanted that power. So if he seen me getting close to that power, it's like, yo, shut him down. Shut him down. No, he doing too much.
Man.
You know what I'm saying? So you got to have, it's like, everybody around me had a real OG around them. You know what I'm saying? You had the, you know, even Podcast Suge. You had Bow Wow, had Jermaine.
For sure.
Nelly had Kuda.
For sure.
You know what I'm saying?
I thought you would have worked with Jermaine. I don't know why in my mind.
But see,
I thought
Jermaine,
this was...
it's crazy because Jermaine and the nigga I was working with hated each other.
That's crazy.
So it was like the niggas I wanted to fuck with, I couldn't even because the blessings was already blocked because this nigga has so many problems already. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, you know, I get it. I get
and you
it.
Roll with the people you roll with.
It's yeah.
Like, so it's like, to me, I was young. I wasn't, at the time, I wasn't knowing all that. But growing up, I learned, like, yo, why Jermaine didn't really fuck with me like that?
Yeah. Boom.
But, you know, we did the hardball together, stuff like that. So, you know, shout out to Jermaine, too. Shout out to Bow Wow, all of them. Like, you know, I felt like there was things that could have been done to make that happen even more. But, you know, when you got two people that's from a whole different decade, because I think it's like, the nigga I was with had stole a song or something from Jermaine back in the day or something. So it was going deeper and further than I was even. It was going deeper and further than I even had to do it.
You gotta understand, man. We, you know, we so in control but so out of control at the same time. It's really God. I keep hearing it, but everything you do is already
It's already written, bro. You know, anytime I move, I tell them, nothing's by coincidence. It's like it's already written because I always wonder, why I didn't do this more. But then when you learn, and if you learn later, it's like, oh, they been had.
Yeah.
That would have never happened. You know what I'm saying?
I hear the stories even with Jermaine Dupri talk about when Puff got into it with Suge and he was in the, you know, they was at his place and all this. You hear all these stories.
It puts you in the middle.
Exactly. So it make you like, dang, you know, like. What, you know, like, you don't never know what's going on behind the scene, right?
Yeah.
You've seen that, being that you've been around a long time.
Yeah.
How was it a depressing thing? Because I've had people on here, and I won't say their name because I'm going to let them live, but that used to have it going on.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, bam, they lose it, everything. Like nobody's checking for them no more. Wait a minute. And when I see them, they you could tell that it's a depressive state it put them in to where they can't figure it out.
You know, it's easy to get stuck in that mode as an artist. You know, I just refuse to let myself get there.
You know where I'm coming from, right?
Yeah, no. It's I know exactly what you're saying. It's like you be up for so long or you be in a great position, then things don't stop going the right stop going the way you
Correct.
Had it going. And it's like you could see it in the dude, you could see it in their face. It's not the same.
Yeah.
I think maybe for like a year or two I might have had that, maybe. I remember feeling like that. I remember feeling like people could just look at you and feel like, damn, this nigga's not doing too well. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Mentally. But I don't feel like, I just was trying to figure it out. You know what I'm saying? I was just trying to figure it out. But one thing, I was always honest with myself. I'm like, yo, I ain't got this shit figured out yet. If I knew all the answers, I'd be up.
You still giving yourself room to grow.
Yeah, most people, and I always say that.
Some people think they already arrived and all this other crazy stuff, you know, and they lose it because they can't really figure it out because you really were never where you needed to be no way. But in your mind, you thought you made it.
Exactly.
You know, it's so much more to it, man. It's a chemistry. I always tell people, the people that I've met in those rooms needed to be there, and you could tell they was supposed to be there. You see what I'm saying? Like, the room don't operate the way that a lot of people would think from the outside looking in.
Right. And that's how I feel like now. It's like I'm supposed to be in that room.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. There it is.
Like before, if I had to question it, it's like y'all wouldn't be in that room right now if I wasn't supposed to be in it.
Yeah.
I feel like, you know, it come a time where you know, okay, this is what I'm supposed to be doing.
I heard that you was it Tyler the Creator or somebody you had issues with or something?
Not really issues. I never met.
What's up with that? Let's talk about that.
Nah, I never met.
Yeah, let's break that down.
Yo,
listen, the beef. They already, you know, I went viral behind
me. Where did that come from?
I can set up a meeting to try to get the nigga in there with you.
I'm going to be honest. Look, I'm probably the only artist in the game that really ain't never had beef with a nigga. Like,
well then, why they say what's
like,
that about?
Like when people mention my name, like it's this.
You running?
Listen
from the question. You see, running from the question.
You said beef. I ain't really never had beef with nobody. Like, I think that it's just. I think it's just like I got one of them situations where, you know, people just know my situation. People know, like, you know, Zane bigger than life, bro. Like my personality always been bigger than my records. Been bigger than any movie I could do. Like, my soul, my spirit is just, when you walk in a room, it's just, you know what I'm saying? Like, Jay-Z don't have to say nothing. When you walk in that room, you just feel it. And that's what I always, you know, pride myself on. Just like, I don't got to say a word. When I walk in, you're going to feel that God. You're going to feel that energy. So sometimes when you got that and you possess that, people just take shots.
I get it.
All these people that ever mentioned me, they never met me in their life.
Mm. I get it.
But I'm like a myth to them. Like, they've been hearing me so long, and they like, yo, why am I still hearing this nigga name 20 years later? Like,
it's been a while.
You know what I'm saying? For a minute, people's probably like, yo, how did the biggest name in the world just disappear? Like, just go away for a minute. But you got to remember, like, nobody made me disappear. I stepped back.
Yeah.
I stepped back, started getting.
It's important that you have, I'll ask you, how important is it to have self-awareness of who you are?
Oh, that's why I stepped back. I seen it going in the direction where I'm like, sooner or later it's gonna crash. You know what I'm saying? Because the paperwork ain't right, everything ain't right, and your spirit ain't right. You're going through a lot of unnecessary people around you. So sometimes you gotta disappear from it and lay low and clear the air.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
It's important.
And
so,
even
go ahead.
No, and I was just gonna say, and sometimes when you taking a break or when you recouping, you know what I mean, you can't be in everybody's grill. People gonna start rumors. They're gonna be, oh, that nigga fell off, or oh, he doing this, or he ain't around. You just like, okay, like you just know you learning. It's like when you start going to church. You been thugging all your life, and you start going to church. It's like people still gonna remember you as the thug. They not knowing the reform you going through. They're not knowing. They're not seeing you go to Bible school. You know what I'm saying? Church every Sunday, Bible school. Like, you trying to change, but sometimes you can't change overnight in front of people.
That's true.
You know, I just wanted
You're something. Not doing it for people. You're doing it for yourself.
Yeah, I wanted something different. I just knew, like, okay, people always trying to say you sound like Tupac, or trying to say, like, everything. I sold a million records. They was trying to take the credit away. So I said, you know what? I'm going to disappear for a minute, get on my writing game. I'm going to get better at writing. I'm going to switch my style up. I'm going to start singing on niggas. I'm going to start singing, rapping, like, you know what I'm saying? My acting roles, I'm going to start, you know, get with the best acting coach. I got the same acting coach as Michael B. Jordan. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, that's dope.
The same lawyers as Kanye.
That boy's stunning on me. Hold on.
Go get the best ones.
Say that again.
You know what I'm saying? Same lawyers. You know what I'm saying?
working.
But that's what you do. Like, I had to, like, just figure it out. You know what I'm saying?
So
I like
what that. Have you learned being on the set of BMF compared to what you didn't know before, like what we were talking about earlier? What is it that you learned?
Just watch your 50, stay working. You know what I'm saying? Stay
That's
working.
Important, ain't it?
He got 16, 17 shows on right now. So it's like, I'm like, how does man sleep? When do this man sleep? And I'm like that. Anybody that know me know I don't sleep. Like, I'm one artist that, you know, I'm really a rock star. Like, I'm being humble right now. I'm being humble in front of y'all. Like, I'm a rock star, bro. Anybody that hang out with me know I'm a rock star. I sleep 2-3 hours a day. Cat naps. We don't sleep. We take cat naps. You know what I'm saying? You don't be. And look how I look. 2-3 hours a day, and way. I still look like I'm 22. I'm not playing because it's like I'm built different. You know what I'm saying? And my gang will tell you, and I ain't bragging. It's just I'm built different.
You're supposed to talk your talk, man. Bro. Stop playing.
I'm built different, bro.
I feel the same way.
I am built different, bro.
So I get it. Like,
I'm built different, bro.
I like that, man. I like it because you got to push yourself.
You know what I mean?
Most people think he being arrogant or something. No, I got to push myself because I'm trying to go to a whole nother level with what I do.
I think with me, people know it's not even arrogant. Like, they see my struggle. They see my hustle. They see me go from duh to duh.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's like, I just look at niggas and say, you know me, dog. don't you know better than count me out, dog. I pop up on something, number one. You know what I'm saying?
Zane, who's been the most influential to you, like, for you during this whole process?
I think the most influential person through this whole process has been my kids, man.
Okay.
Because, I'm trying to lead this legacy, and I got to change the narrative. I had to take control of the narrative. Cause my kids was getting to the point where they were going to school and, you know, the internet is crazy and I didn't want people to just say, yo, remember your dad? Your dad used to do this, whatever happened to him? Oh, whatever happened? Your dad, he's a nobody. So that drive was like knowing that, yo, my kids going to grow up and people going to know about their dad. Now, when they Google and they go, 2 years ago it was like, oh, your dad fell off or boom, boom. Now they go to school and they like, niggas can't stay away from him. Like, yo, your dad on BMF. So it's like, My thing was always leaving a legacy and changing that narrative. Like, no matter what I do, I'm going to make sure that, you know, when they grow up and, you know, when they say my name, like, it's my name is good out here. You know what I'm saying? So that's my whole drive.
Did the pop comparison, did it help your career or did it hurt your career?
I think it helped me. You know what I'm saying? Anytime you compare it to the greatest, you know what I mean? You compare it to the greatest. It helped you. When did Kobe not want to get compared to Jordan, dog?
I get it.
You know what I'm saying? When your idols become your rivals, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
If Pac was alive, we would have been battling. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm the type of person, I'm gonna give you your props. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, you Jay-Z, but when I get in the room, I'm trying to take your head off now. It's like, we competitive with it. You know what I mean? DMX, rest in peace. Like, when I met DMX, we battled for two hours in my room.
Wow.
For 2 hours. Because I told him, I said, bro, I'm the next one. I don't know what you're talking about. You know what I'm saying? They kept telling me about DMX. Oh, this guy's gonna, it's like 96, 97. Like, but I'm in my hood. I'm rapping. I'm number one in my hood. So my man Locke bring DMX to my neighborhood because he had always been talking about it. I'm like, yo, whenever you bring him around here, just let him know I'm gonna eat his face. You know what I'm saying? Rest in peace to DMX.
What was the outcome?
He went down like that?
We had battled for 2 hours in my room and he was like, yo, you nice, kid. You nice, you know? Yo, you nice, son. Like, give you 2 years, you'll be ready. I said, 2 years? You crazy, nigga. I'm ready now, nigga. Fuck you mean 2 years? This 97. 99, that Anywhere shit dropped.
Oh, dang. That was your hit.
He was right.
He was right.
He said, 2 years, you'll be ready. But imagine
Anywhere dropped.
I'm
right
like,
then.
Nigga, I'm ready right now. What you mean?
Yo.
Like, I just rapped 2 hours with you back and forth. But he was just like, 2 years, you'll be ready. And rest in peace to DMX.
That boy told the truth.
He was right.
Man, and that's ain't that something?
But people don't know that. But those are things that, like, make me who I am.
No.
The fact that I know I battled DMX for.
And
I wouldn't say battle like.
He's still a big homie, right? Like,
I wouldn't say battle like dissing each other. It's more like, you kick a rhyme, I kick a rhyme. You kick a rhyme, I kick a rhyme. All my neighborhood friends is there. They like, yo, like, I'm telling this story.
That's epic.
I'm telling this story, and it's 13 people that's still alive that can say, y'all was there.
Y'all ain't even recorded, man. Nobody had no phone back then. Nobody had nothing back then.
I was only like.
They had the big phone.
Bro, I was like 16, bro.
I know. I heard the year you said it was.
Yeah, I'm 16. It's like 97.
Yeah, 96, 97. Yeah. Ain't nobody had. You barely had all this stuff that everybody
had. He only had Get At Me Dog out. He had one song.
Yeah.
Out. You know what I mean? But he was bigger than life, and you knew he was finna be the next one. But here I go. I'm like, man.
So what, Lil Bow Wow and all those guys, man, I know you dealt with them, come up around the same time.
Yeah.
Same circles, man. So, I mean, you felt like, okay, when you see it, was anybody you like, oh, yeah, he's making his run right now. I'm finna make my run. Or how did you, I'm talking about in the rap game. You know what I'm saying?
You know what? I always just like the way that they did, you know what I'm saying? Like, I just like the fact that, you know what I'm saying, how he had that Jermaine shit.
Yeah,
you know
that was dope.
Always,
that was dope.
You know what I'm saying? That's one thing I always knew and I respected about them is how they just kept that whole thing.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And with me, it was never like that, though, man.
I'm
a hater, bro. I'm so confident in what I do, bro.
No, I get
that
it.
That I would see them, congratulate them. You know what I'm saying?
Sure.
Maybe sometime I would seem standoffish because I'm so like I'm an introvert, bro.
Yeah.
I'm like, I'm the coolest person you walk up to me, but I like my space. So I might not come up to you like, yo, let's get in the studio, boom, boom. Cause niggas do that shit to me all the time too. I like it to naturally happen. So a lot of these artists, I feel like before, I mean, they probably thought I was standoffish because, you know, I'm letting you have your space, nigga. You know what I'm saying? Like, but now it's like I'm a little bit more different. Now I see a nigga, I'm like, what's up, nigga? Let's get in the lab, nigga. Because just so I know I said it.
Yeah.
And it's like a nigga said, let's go right now. I'm like, let's go right now. But at least you know you said before. I'm like, damn, I'll never know if it was going to be cool because I didn't say nothing.
Damn. So no one intimidates you?
No one intimidates me. It's just more like I'm so humble that I'm like, yo, I'm not going to bother him while he's eating. I'm not going to bother him while he's eating. I'm not going to bother him while he's... But now I'm just like, yo, bro, what's good, dog? You know what I mean? So
let's get
now
this
it's
done.
Just, now this time around, it's just like, you know, not missing that opportunity and just, you know, and just knowing that, you know, a closed mouth don't get fed.
True.
You know?
So what's next for Lil Zane?
Man, what's next?
You going to get some more music? You ain't messing
course.
With it?
Of course. No, people don't know, man. Listen, man. The music shit is crazy. Listen, man.
So when you drop,
I got two singles out right now. I got 325 out, 325 AM, new video out. I got a single called Rolly out. About to drop this new single called Bad Vibes. I've been dropping hella videos
at
the back.
Did you start working more when you seen the BMF thing? Like,
nah,
all right, people gonna
I always kept doing music, like every day.
I'm talking about dropping like videos and all that stuff.
I was dropping music.
You was already
been dropping
doing
music
that.
Since like,
okay.
You know, I feel like it's just, I always been dropping music since like 2017. I just really started dropping music crazy. But I knew the BMF was probably going to pick it up.
Yes, people going to put more eyes on you, right?
Yeah, so, you know, but I got over, you know, 5,000 songs recorded, man. I've been recording songs every day since, you know, 2000, bro. You know what I mean? I never stopped recording. Like, one thing I did, I never stopped recording. Like, no matter how many years I didn't put out no album, I went to the studio damn near every day, though.
Man.
You know what I mean? So you can only imagine how much music I have. Last night, I performed at this.
I seen the DFW pop up.
I did all new music.
You did.
I did a lot of acapella shit.
And he left. I should have came.
You know what I'm
I didn't know you was gonna be doing all that. I'd have showed up.
Yeah, but the question that she answered, what's next for me? You know, I got a TV show that I'm executive producing and starring in. It's called Dead Serious. It's a zombie show.
Okay.
A show about zombies, like zombies that are self-aware. Self-aware zombies. They know they're dead. They talk shit. Slick talking self-aware zombies. So. It's like Walking Dead meets Zombieland meets Shaun of the Dead type shit. It's a horror comedy TV show, you know what I'm saying? Pitching it to like Showtime, HBO, shit like that. So, you know, I'm working on that right now. I'm really excited about that. We just shot the pilot for that.
Mm-hmm.
And that's me being on that 50 shit, you know what I'm saying? Shout out to 50, man, because
motivation.
I respect him so much. Like, being on that BMF set, it just motivated me. Like, I'm like, yo, this nigga run this whole shit. Like, they could write my character off any day. You know what I'm saying?
That's true.
Thank God he not. You know what I'm saying? Kasaki,
stop
that
playing,
nigga.
Man.
Yo, 50 won't do that, Kasaki, that nigga, man. You know what I'm saying? But, like, you know, but it just gave me that sense, like, yo, even him, when he do Kane, he write himself in a little bit,
yeah.
But he the EP. You know what I'm saying? So it just gave me that drive, like, yo, I'm gonna take this little thing they give me and I wanna, how can
run
I,
with it.
I'm gonna take this fish they give me and how can I just create a whole, my own empire, my own universe. You know what I'm saying? That power is a universe. He got power, he got this. So I'm just watching the blueprint. You know, I'm learning like everybody else, but I'm watching my nigga and I'm just like, yo, I want that.
Man.
So I need to know your top three artists of
all time.
Dead or alive. Any genre.
I would say 50. Pop,
50 number one.
50
pop.
And Ice Cube.
That was quick. Huh. That was quick. He was quick with it.
I know.
You
and
everybody
I said Ice
else
Cube
like,
because Ice Cube got the film and the television.
He dope too.
50 got the film and the television.
Yeah.
And Pac had the film and the television.
Hey.
I studied the best, bro.
You did your thing on that pick quick too.
Yeah.
He quick with it.
I always want Ice T. Like, I like people like that. LL. People that just do what I do. they took over the TV and the music. You know what I'm saying?
If you could go back and talk to the younger you, man, and you went back and had a conversation with yourself, and you could give yourself some advice, what would it be?
If I can go back to the younger,
I'm talking about 16.
If I can go back 15. To the younger me and give myself the advice, I would say, focus, stay focused. Stay focused. You know what I'm saying? Stay focused. I'm more focused than ever now. Yeah. Stay focused. It's easy as a young artist to get unfocused, bro. You got the women, you got the money, you got the drugs, you got the crew. Stay focused. You know what I'm saying? And go for it. Stay focused and go for it. Like, that's one of the main things. I feel like artists, we end up in jail, we end up dead, we end up, you know what I'm saying? Just stay focused, like, stay focused.
I got to ask you about Young Dolph, but I want to do it in a way to where it really ain't about him indirectly, really. Just the way you move as an artist now.
Now,
because of the way you see it, not just him, but it's a cloud of smoke over all the, a lot of artists is dying, whether it be gun violence or however it may happen. How does that affect you mentally as far as seeing them, and how does it affect the way you move?
Definitely just make you think for the future, man. You know what I'm saying? I own my masters now.
That's dope.
I'm working on re-recording my first album over so I could remaster it and own those masters to my first album so the fans could start going to buy that. Just really thinking about owning my masters, changing my everyday habits. You know what I'm saying? Like changing your everyday habits, you know? The things we used to love to do, unfortunately, we in a position now to where, you know, we on TV, it's things going, people hate you for no reason. So you got to change your mood. You got to change your daily habits. You know what I'm saying? If I used to go to the same gym every day, I started changing. I go to another gym. I might drive 30 minutes out of the way to go to the gym now just to change the habit. You know what I'm saying? Like when I'm leaving the club, I'm watching, you know, of course, bought more pistols. You know what I'm saying? Like, I ain't gonna cat with you.
For real.
I ain't gonna cat with you. Bought more pistols. You know what I'm saying? But then, you know, just change your habits, because you had a thing on you and still get.
Oh, you can still get it.
Still get it. You know what I'm saying? Change your habits. And like I said, man, staying that stupid. Artists just get restless sometimes. You know what I'm saying? We want to just go out, man. I got to do something. Man, chill your ass at home, nigga.
That's it.
Get in the studio, bro.
That's
in the
it.
Studio, like, keep yourself so busy that you ain't even got time for the streets.
No,
I'm so busy, bro. I ain't got, like, I've been in the streets for the last 15 years. The reason why I'm here right now is because I've been in the streets. Even though I wasn't on TV, I stayed active. Like, I was out here in the streets. I'm in the clubs. I'm in niggas' face. Like, that's why I'm here now. Now it's, like, to a point where I'm just like, yo, get out the streets, stay at the studio. I try to stay so big. I'm on a set, I'm in the studio, try to stay out the streets, bro, because ain't nothing in the streets.
Man.
You want to give back, bro, and you want to be, oh, I'm in the streets, I'm giving back. But it's like, stay out the streets, dog.
Man, it'd be right at your doorstep. You know, it usually happens in your own city. Do you agree with the fact that it's tough to stay in your own city? I think I asked DeRez Deshaun that, didn't
I?
Should you move out of your city when you get to blowing and going, or should you stay in your city? And
man,
what should you do?
I mean, you know what? I'm from Atlanta. I still live in Atlanta, but I moved out of Atlanta.
Okay.
If you think about it, it might be true. Like, I was born and raised in Atlanta, but I lived in Cali for 8 years.
Okay.
I lived in Miami for 5 years.
So that
years.
Helps.
I did move around.
Yeah.
So I gave my city time to miss me.
That's it.
Niggas didn't know my moves every day. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So I might agree on that.
Oh.
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
I might agree on that. Like, you know.
Yeah, it's something Boosie say. He say that. That's where I hear that coming from. Like,
yeah,
you know, it's like, well, Jesus, a prophet's not without honor in his own country. Like, you're gonna get that hate. People that you went to school with,
you go to other
people
cities,
that, yeah.
You're bigger than what
they gonna love you.
City, you know what I mean? Like Atlanta, everybody used to seeing people. So
for sure,
you know, you'll never get the money in Atlanta that you'll get in Alabama or you're getting, because we so used to seeing people. It's like, you know, we see Future in the club all the time. We see Thug, like, in the club all the time. So, you know, but when you go to them different cities, they go crazy. You know
what I'm saying? Yeah, for sure.
They go crazy because they're not used to it.
Yeah.
So,
man, You got anything else,
my
boy?
Sir, that's it.
Man, hey, man, look here, man. I didn't enjoy this. You done made my day, man.
Thank you, bro.
Man, you know I'm getting old. I need all this. You know what I'm saying?
Man. Hey,
I'm
we need it.
Say, man, I look, when you in town, if I'm in ATL, or if I'm in Cali, wherever I'm at, and if we decide, we're going to link, we're going to link. So, man, thank you so much for coming on the show.
Thank you for having me. This is like Boss Talk for real.
Hey.
Yeah.
Hey, Lil Zane, been on Boss Talk 101, y'all. We having a good time.
Yo, man.
Check
Appreciate
it, man.
Y'all having me, too.
Say, man, how can people get a hold of you? Which
yo,
we know.
Social media, man, Lil Zane's World. You know what I'm saying? Facebook, Lil Zane. Twitter, Lil Zane. You know, social media, Lil Zane's World, though, man. Look me up.
Check it, man.
Yeah.
Hey, man, we love you, man. It's been another great segment of Boss Talk 101.
And we out. Boss.